Growing up, my grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us, and it never asks for anything back.
It is a way of life to always honor the environment. It's not something that you just can turn on and off. It's a living daily lifestyle.
And that acknowledgement is a way to acknowledge that we're coexisting in this land with the native people, and we should acknowledge that this is actually their traditional territory. But at the same time, we are all guests to this land.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Hello, welcome. Thank you for joining our last The Ancient World lecture series in collaboration with the Department of Classics and Religion with the University of Calgary. We have my colleague Zoritza and myself Kai from Calgary Public Library and Dr. Kendall Hayden from University of Calgary as our presenter. Before we start with tonight's program, I would like to acknowledge that February is the Black History Month, and we would like to show you the video of Viola Desmond.
All I wanted was to see a movie. One down, please.
I can't sell downstairs tickets to you people.
How dare they?
I could afford to buy the more expensive ticket. I run my own business.
But they refused to take my money.
They left me there all night.
On what charge?
They said I didn't pay the theater tax. But it was really about color.
Sister Desmond, appeal this conviction and your community will stand behind you.
Do you have any idea what this will do to us?
So what are you going to do?
Make it right.
Viola Desmond's case inspired Nova Scotia's civil rights movement. She was pardoned 63 years later based on the injustice of her conviction.
Wonderful. Thank you, Zoritza. Before we start, I would like to go over some housekeeping. The program are scheduled from 7 p.m. to 8:30 p.m. Presentation is about an hour, and we will have question period at the end of the presentation. You may ask your question via chat throughout the presentation, and please direct those questions to myself, Kai, and you can access the chat function on the bottom of the Zoom screen. And now, without further ado, let me introduce you to our presenter for tonight. Dr. Kendall Hayden holds a PhD in classics from the University of Nottingham and is currently a lecturer with the University of Calgary's Department of Classic and Religion. Dr. Hayden's research interests and area of specialty include Spartan studies, cultural history, literary analysis, sexuality and gender studies, and interdisciplinary approaches to the study of the ancient world, with a current research focused on constructions and depictions of Spartan masculinity in the classical sources. So now, enjoy the presentation. Dr. Kendall Hayden, please.
Hello, just bear with me as I share my screen. Let's see, here we go. Sorry, I love Zoom. one moment. There, I think we're going now. Okay. Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for coming to hear me speak tonight. And many thanks to the Calgary Public Library and the University of Calgary's Department of Classics and Religion for putting on this excellent series. My talk tonight is entitled Feminist Misinterpretations of Plato? And I must begin by saying that I feel a tiny bit guilty about this. You see, I feel a bit like I've lured you here under some false pretenses with this slightly sensationalist title. And what it really is just a nod, a somewhat tongue-in-cheek nod, to the book, which I owe a great debt of gratitude for starting me and thinking about the topic of Plato and gender in the first place. And this is, of course, Feminist Interpretations of Plato. You see, in my research with classics, I do a lot of work on ancient genders and sexualities, but in my work, I tend to use a social constructionist methodology rather than an approach that uses academic feminism. And when I first got my hands on this volume, it really struck me not only how much my research and my approach has in common with feminist approaches, but also the differences that arise from our differing methodologies and how they impact our interpretation of the ancient text. And to me, this really highlights how much the interdisciplinary studies and approaches have to offer the field of classics and how different ways of reading these ancient texts bring really new and vibrant interpretations to texts that might not be apparent if we were just looking at them using traditional methods of historiography and literary analysis alone. So I really wanted to showcase that tonight by giving you one little example of that, and indeed taking really a very tiny bit of text from Plato's Republic, namely Plato's description of how breeding and procreation should be conducted amongst his guardian class within the ideal society, and showing you that if we take Plato's treatment of women in this passage as our subject of analysis, but place different lenses on our readings of the text, very different interpretations can emerge from the very same text. Okay, so I want to give you a bit of background first here, and apologies for everything dinging all over the place. I thought I had muted my various devices, but apparently I have not. Okay, so over the years, Plato has been of considerable interest to a number of feminist scholars, and Plato's positions on the subjects of the equality of the sexes and the rights of women in particular has been the topic of some debate in academic feminism. Scholarly opinion about how to interpret Plato in these areas is quite wide-ranging, actually, with some hailing Plato as some sort of proto-feminist, whereas others asserting that Plato is in fact a rampant misogynist whose writings on women are fundamentally incompatible with feminist thought, and still are others arguing for varying interpretations of Plato's views on women, which would place him somewhere between these two extremes. Now, those who would take Plato to be an advocate for the equality of the sexes tend to base their arguments in his discussion of the way of life that would be prescribed for the guardian class in the Republic. Now, I'm sure that many of you have some familiarity with the Republic as a work, but for those who might be less familiar, I just want to give you a brief sort of broad strokes look at it. In short, it's a Socratic dialogue wherein Socrates and friends set out ostensibly to discuss the nature of justice, but soon get onto the top of a topic rather of how to create the best society. And when I say Socrates and friends, it's mainly Socrates who is in fact serving as the mouthpiece of all of Plato's great ideas in this piece, with his buddies mostly saying things like, yes, Socrates, and I agree, Socrates, and you are certainly right about that, Socrates, but I digress. The majority of the dialogue in Republic is concerned with how the way of life would be arranged for the guardian class within the society of Republic. And this is the class that would be responsible for protecting the city and who would devote themselves entirely to this task. And as a result of this, everything about the way of life that is undertaken by this class of people, from their education to how they would live to indeed their procreation, has to be very carefully managed, according to Plato, in order to cultivate the correct attitudes amongst this class of people. And in terms of where the guardians rank in the status and hierarchy within Republic society, they are considered to be an elite group, being second only in status to the Republic's philosopher rulers, who are themselves chosen from the best of the guardians. And when Plato starts discussing the philosopher rulers, the terminology gets a bit squidgy, because up until that point, he'd been referring to the guardians as the guardians, full stop. And then once he introduces the philosopher rulers, you get this idea that, well, the rulers are the true guardians of the Republic, and these other ones, these sort of lesser guardians whose main business is the protection and the soldiering in the city, they're the auxiliaries who support these true guardians. But for the sake of simplicity today, even though we will be primarily talking about the sort of group of auxiliary guardians, we're just going to call them the guardians to make life a bit simple. So, why do some feminist scholars look to Republic to argue that Plato advocated equality of the sexes? Well, first, Republic is the only work in which Plato expresses the idea of an entirely genderless capacity for virtue. Plato in the Republic asserts that both males and females have the potential to possess the unique excellences and nature that is required for guardianship. And second, Republic is the only one of Plato's works which advocates for the complete integration of women into the public sphere. In the ideal society of the Republic, all those who have the nature required for guardianship would receive the same education and partake in a single common way of life, regardless of their biological sex. Whereas in other of Plato's work, we see more limited roles for women. For instance, in the Laws, Plato's mouthpiece in this work, not Socrates this time, but rather just an unnamed Athenian character, commends Spartan society, for instance, for the way in which it regulated the life of its men, but criticizes the Spartan lawgiver for failing to do something similar for women. So Plato's plan for the so-called second best society in the Laws does in fact include some integration of women into the public sphere, but this is not to the extent that we see in Republic. And indeed, the Athenian character in the Laws warns that women will resist being brought into public life, and indeed resist it violently. Lastly, remarks made by Plato elsewhere tend to be fairly denigrating to women, which of course has been found problematic to the interpretation of Plato's other works as in any way feminist. One such example can be found in the Timaeus, which is another of these Socratic dialogues. This one is primarily concerned with cosmology, and which lays out Plato's famous theory of forms. In the Timaeus, we get a discussion of the consequence of having a mismatch between body and soul that includes the following quote. According to the probable account, all those creatures generated as men who proved themselves cowardly and spent their lives in wrongdoing were transformed at their second incarnation into women. So it's understandable that the Timaeus is not really the go-to text to argue that Plato had a high estimation of women. However, even within the Republic, which establishes identical rights and responsibilities for male and female guardians, scholars have made arguments against interpreting the situation and the regulations that Plato presents in the Republic as being tantamount to equality between the sexes. Many such arguments concern Plato's approach to guardian excellence and how guardians are to be educated, and they include such such ideas as that the excellences that are enshrined as best by the Republic are unambiguously male excellences, that Plato asserts that women generally embody desirable qualities less often than do men, that Plato's educational regime follows a male pattern of development, and that the condition of equality proposed in the Republic necessitates the de-sexing of the female guardian, rendering her a de facto male. Now, it's not my intention tonight to expound excessively on the debate over whether the idea of excellence in the Republic is truly and fundamentally genderless. I happen to think that it is, but I should probably get on to my actual topic at some point. So let's get to it, shall we? So with those arguments I just mentioned, there are a variety of positions that are taken by feminist scholars on all of these issues. However, there does seem to be one large stumbling block in Plato's arrangements for guardian life, even for those who would most like to view Plato as an advocate for the equal rights of women, and that is the mandates that Republic establishes governing procreation amongst the guardian class. Considerable attention has been given to this by feminist scholars, and this topic, which is found in book five, roughly between 449C to 468E, is given tons and tons of attention. Forests have been felled, and to this date, I'm not saying that one doesn't exist, but to this date, I have yet to encounter a feminist analysis of Plato's breeding arrangement that doesn't view them as particularly oppressive to women. Some focuses of debate regarding this section of the Republic have been that the patriarchal structures are perceived to be in place in Plato's ideal, and that Plato employs masculinist language in his discussion of breeding arrangements, that there is a lack of female autonomy or sexual choice in the breeding program. And of course, this all feeds into the discussion of whether or not the attitudes towards women that Plato expresses here and elsewhere can be deemed in any way feminist in nature. And of those issues I just mentioned, they usually fall into broadly two categories of issues. The first is issues with the language, the way Plato talks about men and women when discussing procreation. And the second is, of course, with the regulations and the mandates themselves. And it's interesting because the issue with language can be really well exemplified by this sort of notorious phrase that you'll see many people commenting on when they talk about Plato and his treatment of women in Republic, which is this notorious community of women and children, which you can see here on this slide. This is the bit of text where Plato introduces the mandate for guardian, and I'll quote here, that these women shall all be common to all men, and that none shall cohabit with any privately, and the children shall be common, and no parent shall know its own offspring, nor any child its parent. And this has been interpreted by a number of scholars as relegating women essentially to the status of commonly held possessions, especially as it is discussed within the sort of larger context of the guardian's communal way of life, which prohibits them from holding private property or having private residence. And as you can see on this slide, and also this one, which has a few more excerpts, this turn of phrase pops up quite a few times in the Republic. And the interesting thing about it, despite this sort of ominous tone of the community of women and children, is that it tends to be the lesser issue for feminist scholars, because most of the objections that can be raised by this idea tend to be more related to Plato's choice of language rather than any tangible disadvantage to women in these mandates. So it's really a problem of phrasing. Plato tends to discuss things using masculine and patriarchal language. And scholars tend to ascribe this partly to the fact that Plato was, for better or worse, a product of his own time and society. So even if his ideas, by the standards of his society, are quite revolutionary and not particularly patriarchal in nature, oftentimes his language still tends to be. And moreover, part of the masculinist slant we can see in Plato's discussion of this community of women and children can be ascribable to the fact that up until book five, it is not in fact revealed that women would actually be guardians in the first place. And when it is revealed that women will be guardians as well, this is meant to be the sort of bombshell that Socrates drops on his friends, which really shatters their presuppositions on the intrinsic natures and abilities of men and women. So before book five, all the discussion of the hypothetical guardians has been about he's and hims and on it goes. And the first mention actually of the community of women and children is brought up before this big reveal that women would be guardians. So it's understandable how he didn't want to sort of let the cat out of the bag too early. But unfortunately, after the reveal is made, as we can see in the number of passages we have, it is a phrase that continues to be repeated. And generally speaking, Plato will continue to talk about guardians using this sort of male language and male model, perhaps just for stylistic consistency. So a number of scholars are inclined to give Plato a bit of a pass on his somewhat unfortunate phrasing in his discussion. Now, the more difficult issue for scholars, and the one I find most interesting, concerns the arrangements and regulations that Republic sets out for guardian breeding themselves. So in Republic, procreation is to mainly take place in the form of these sort of fixed marriage lotteries, which are not marriages in any true or enduring sense, but rather these are specific ceremonies wherein selections are made so that rulers can temporarily match guardians into temporary breeding pairs. And I quote, "It follows from our former admissions," I said, "that the best men must cohabit with the best women in as many cases as possible, and the worst with the worst in the fewest, and that the offspring of the one must be reared and of the other not, if the flock is to be as perfect as possible. And the way in which this is all brought to pass must be unknown to any but the rulers, if again the herd of guardians is to be as free as possible from dissension." "Most true," says Socrates' friend. "We shall then have to ordain certain festivals and sacrifices in which shall bring together the brides and the bridegrooms, and our poets must compose hymns suitable for the marriages that then take place." So it's to be surrounded with all these trappings and honor and religiosity, but really it's for these practical purposes of eugenics, essentially. So the other way that sexual intercourse and ideally procreation is meant to occur amongst the guardians of fertile age is as follows, and I quote again, "And on the young men surely who excel in war and other pursuits, we must bestow honors and prizes, and in particular, the opportunity of more frequent intercourse with the women, which will at the same time be a plausible pretext for having them beget as many of the children as possible." Now, understandably, feminist interpretations of this text often assert that these arrangements are deeply patriarchal, favoring men at the expense of women, especially in the representation of women as prizes awarded to men, and deeply oppressive to women, highlighted by the fact that females lack choice whether or not they want to participate in sexual intercourse or procreation, and even if they are willing to do so, their lack of choice concerning their procreative partner. Now, while I would wholeheartedly agree that Plato's description of guardian life is in no way feminist and is fundamentally incompatible with feminist values, I would argue that the text does not necessarily favor men at the expense of women. How can this be, you might ask? The breeding program certainly seems to oppress women. Well, yes, it does oppress women, but no more than anybody else. And I would argue that the view of Republic's guardian breeding measures as oppressive to women in particular is largely dependent on the lens through which the text is read. Now, it is not my intention here to imply that employing feminist methodological frameworks is not either applicable or useful as a way to approach Plato's treatment of women. Incidentally, this is a debate that has been and continues to be undertaken by scholars. And if you're interested in it, I would recommend a book by Stella Sanford called Plato and Sex, which devotes considerable attention to questions of the applicability of feminist frameworks and even modern understandings of the concept of sex in general to the study of Plato. And I point this book out not only because it gives a very thorough treatment to this topic, but it's also quite a good read if you're interested in, well, Plato and sex. But I digress. Methodological debates aside, it's certainly the case that feminist readings of Plato have produced an abundance of interesting and informative scholarship. However, on this one particular topic of Republic's Guardian Breeding Program, I would argue that the ideological concerns of feminism have colored several scholars' interpretations and has actually prevented some authors who view the breeding program as advantageous to men at the expense of women from seeing the ways in which the exact opposite can be true. And I really think that this is because modern feminism, not only in academia, but as a political movement, is not rightly merely concerned with the equal rights and opportunities of men and women, but is also intrinsically entwined with the liberal values of individual emancipation and self-determination, which means that any feminist analysis of Republic will necessarily impose an external set of ideals onto the text. This is because feminism as an ideology is fundamentally at odds with the worldview Plato expresses in Republic, which is entirely unconcerned with the emancipation of any individual, be they male or female, but rather withholds the right of self-determination from everyone within the ideal society in the pursuit of the highest communal good. So the quote on this slide here is just one of several statements in the Republic that make Plato's lack of concern for individual happiness abundantly clear. And interestingly enough, a number of feminist analyses of Plato have in fact acknowledged his equal lack of concern for issues of male liberation, and yet feminist interpretations of the marital arrangements often continue to be colored almost exclusively by this ideal of female liberation, which causes the authors to both, I would say, to some degree, misinterpret Plato's position and also overlook those important implications that I will discuss in a moment. And before I suggest an alternative way to view the text, I do want to respond to a couple of these issues that have been raised. So to respond to the issue that has been raised regarding a guardian woman's lack of choice over whether or not she wishes to engage in sex, the idea that anyone would not want to have sex does not even enter into Plato's mind. Rather, Plato takes it as a given that all members of society, whether male or female, would have a continual active interest in sexual activity, if only for the sort of erotic concerns that would arise, as he suggests, due to their cohabitation. In fact, as you can see in the text on the slide, Plato doesn't even consider that it would be a problem to try to convince any of the guardians to have sex. Rather, the difficulty he anticipates is how the rulers would be able to prevent guardians from engaging in undesirable sexual unions, which he presents as a concern not due to any stigma around the sexual act itself, but out of concern that inferior offspring would be produced by random unions. And speaking of random unions, I will next respond to the objection raised that female guardians have no choice in their procreative partner. So Plato makes it very clear in his text that who procreates with who is a matter not for any of the individuals involved, but rather for the Republic rulers to decide. And in the mention that we discussed a few moments ago of the more frequent opportunities for intercourse as a prize awarded to male guardians for excellence, Plato makes no mention that the guardian so honored would have any say over who he would be having sex with. So while the language Plato uses here is indeed masculine in slant, that problem with phrasing again, it's clear that neither male nor female guardian would have the option of choosing their own sexual partner, and neither male nor female guardian would have the option of declining to participate in procreative activities if they were called upon to do so, meaning the lack of sexual choice and choice of partner is something that male and female guardians would share in equally. In fact, the only thing even nearing sexual choice in Republic for guardians of fertile age is a passage on your screen here where it's suggested that the one who distinguishes himself in battle should be able to claim the right to kiss whomever he pleases. I'll quote, and I add to the law the provision that during the campaign, none whom he wishes to kiss be allowed to refuse, so that if one is in love with anyone, male or female, he may be the more eager to win the prize. And even though the hypothetical subject in this passage is male, in line with Plato's typical pattern, the passage does not explicitly exclude the possibility that warriors celebrated in this way could be female as well. Indeed, since Plato is explicit that women should serve martial roles and participate in the defense of the city, it is likely that that guardian women could receive these same kinds of honors. And it's worth highlighting here that in this instance, the object of the honored guardian's desire could be either male or female, and neither male nor female has the right to refuse the kiss. There is one mention of full sexual autonomy for members of the guardian class in the Republic, and this is for those who are older than the age range that Plato sets out as ideal for procreation. So, Socrates asserts that these individuals will have complete sexual autonomy. And you'll note in this case that the sexual self-determination is presented as equal for both males and females. I'll quote, "But when I take it, the men and women have passed the age of lawful procreation, we shall leave the men free to form such relations with whomever they please, except daughter and mother and their direct descendants and ascendants. And likewise, the women, save with son and father and so on." So in short, if someone's too old to procreate, they can do what they want. But during the fruitful years, the act of procreation is to be relegated to the confines of state-sanctioned mandates and is represented as not only a duty, but also an honor by which both male and female guardians enhance the society to which they are devoted. And through this, Plato suggests that sexual intercourse is an activity that he expects both men and women to always be interested in engaging in, both for reasons of pleasure and indeed for reasons of honor. Now, I can sense objections. We can certainly argue that Plato was wrong to think that everyone in society would want to have sex literally all the time, or that with the general lack of autonomy, Plato's ideal society does not sound like a very nice place to live. Indeed, even Plato's own characters make that latter argument, as you see in the slide, which has that quote from earlier where Adamantus basically says that Socrates would wouldn't everyone be miserable if they have to live like this? And Socrates essentially responds, I think they'll be all right, but I don't really care since I designed the system for the well-being of society as a whole, not for individual happiness. But anyway, what I'm trying to get at here is that, well, it can seem like the guardian breeding program is more oppressive to women than men because of the decidedly patriarchal tone of the text. Again, that trouble with language and phrasing, the actuality of the situation that Plato sets out is equal oppression for all. So it really is best to leave any kind of ideals of liberation and self-determination off the table when we discuss who is advantaged and disadvantaged by Republic's Guardian breeding program. And once concerns of liberation are removed, the remaining picture is one in which procreation is presented to all guardians as an opportunity that is desirable and to be sought after. So then how should we judge who is advantaged and disadvantaged by Republic's procreative mandates? Well, I would suggest that before applying any external ideological standard to the text, it's useful to judge the society of Republic by its own internal ideological standard, which is established by the text itself. And here, honor is the key. As those of you who have any familiarity with Republic will know, when we are talking about the Guardian class, we are talking about a group of people who Plato not only characterizes as being, he calls them the people who have thumos, that's the spirited part of the nature. This is their driving factor, and people who are thumos or spirit driven are honor seekers. That's in their definition. For instance, when he's discussing the various societies that exist, the type of society that he equates with Sparta is also a thumos driven society. They're honor lovers and honor seekers. So people have drawn parallels between the guardians that are described in Republic with the way of life and the values of Spartan society, which is actually what got me onto the topic of Plato and gender in the first place, but I'm digressing. So not only are they spirited by their nature, we're talking about a group of people who have been carefully educated, molded, and basically brainwashed from the earliest possible age to live and breathe for their city and to value the honor attained by their contributions to their city above all else. Honor is the highest currency for the guardians of the Republic, so we should not take ideological concerns and status and honor lightly. And that's why I think that this is really the best lens to apply when we read the text. So let's do that. Let's take Plato's work in the spirit he presented it and see who benefits from the Guardian breeding program in terms of honor and competitive achievement. So, as I mentioned, the majority of guardian procreation is meant to be accomplished by this marriage lottery. And it's a bit of a tricksy thing that Plato does here, because it's a fixed marriage lottery, but also it's wrapped in all of this deceit. You see, the Republic's rulers will deceitfully present the lottery as determined entirely by chance in order to diminish discord amongst the guardians. But in reality, the lottery is, as we discussed, rigged in order to ensure ideal pairings of the best with the best. Plato is big on deceit as a social tool. However, whereas the inferior guardian men who are not chosen to procreate in the marriage lottery might be inclined to chalk their exclusion from this opportunity up to bad luck, this marriage lottery nevertheless creates an ideological association between procreation and excellence, because to the average guardian, especially since it is wrapped up in all these trappings of religiosity and ceremony and mythology, to the average guardian, if someone succeeds and is selected by this marriage lottery, they are divinely favored. They're chosen by the gods. And if the same individuals keep winning marriage lotteries over and over and over, the sense that, you know, there's something more than random chance going on here would be enhanced. So this this perception of divine favor would be all the stronger. And this association that is created between success and eros is made stronger and more concrete by the inclusion of opportunities to engage in sexual intercourse and procreation more frequently amongst this list of prizes afforded to excellent guardian men. And while Plato presents these measures as purely practical, you know, the society will want to guarantee that its genetic heritage will be as fine as possible, and so will ensure that its children are sired by the finest specimens. The side effect of this is that the right to procreate becomes an ideological marker of personal excellence and high status within the guardian class. And frequent participation in procreative acts would serve to further enhance an individual guardian's reputation. And well, Socrates initially asserts that the marriages are arranged in this way to ensure that the best men mate with the best women, the subsequent discussion proceeds in such a way so as to imply that it is only men who are in competition to ensure the best pairings. If you look at the bold bits on the slide here, you'll notice that in the marriage lotteries, the lots are fixed so that subpar males will not be chosen to breed, but there is no mention of subpar females. So procreation is a prize which the language of the text implies guardian men will have to compete over, but which guardian women are automatically given. Thus, the honor associated with procreation brings into the text a gendered imbalance to Plato's otherwise genderless understanding of guardian excellence. And if we apply this interpretation to those instances where extra opportunities for sex or procreation are given outside of the marriage lotteries, again, it really changes how we view those instances. You'll remember the feminist view of the instances where sex is awarded as a prize to male guardians for their excellence is to view women as the passive prize for excellence over which the men compete. But in light of what we just discussed, and in light of Plato's sort of overarching representation of sex and procreation in the Republic, I would argue that it is not the women that are the prize for excellence, but rather the opportunity to procreate itself. So if we now view the sexual opportunity rather than the women as the prize, again, it's only men who have to prove their excellence to receive this prize, whereas women will be awarded this prize without the necessity to accomplish something notable in war or other spheres. So the implications of both these measures is that once a woman qualifies for membership in the guardian class, her excellence, at least as it relates to procreation, is assured, whereas guardian men must prove and reprove their merit with all these successive competitions. It never ends. They're forced to continually prove their merit in order to secure opportunities to procreate. And as the text suggests that the honor associated with being selected for procreation would be immense, perhaps one of the highest honors for guardianship. So we should not take the advantage this would give women lightly, because remember, when Plato talks about the guardians who are worthy of procreating, he is talking about the best of the best. And it seems that all guardian women fall into this ideal category, whereas it is possible that some guardian men would never make the cut, so to speak. Added to this, if we look at what Republic does with the ideology of kinship, there is a possibility for yet another layer of ideological advantage that the breeding arrangements would afford women. Much scholarly discussion has been given to the fact that in Republic, Plato seeks to subvert kinship bonds, and instead he redirects familial allegiance to allegiance to the state. Now, this is generally true, but if you look at the slide here, you'll see that with the guardian, Plato doesn't really seek to destroy familial feelings. Rather, he seeks to extend it. Plato takes this terminology and ideology that are associated with the ideals of kinship. He appropriates it for his own usages, and he uses it in a sort of state context to ensure that all guardians would feel bonds similar to those of kinship towards all other guardians. But Plato's employment of familial terms in order to create cohesion amongst the guardian class has important ideological implications if we consider the fact that he is unable to entirely do away with biologically based connections. You will see on this slide that in order to avoid inbreeding, Socrates dictates that all children born from any given round of procreation or procreation event, for lack of a better term, would consider all adults who took part in that round or event to be their parents. So this measure maintains the communal spirit of diminishing the impact of individual kinship bonds, but has ideological implications for procreators, seeing as there is in fact to be special acknowledgement for those who are involved in a procreation event by all offspring that are produced by that event. Now, this maintenance of parental acknowledgement, even diffused as it is throughout all the guardians who participated in a particular ceremony, would have ideological significance. In fact, it would have twofold ideological significance. So on one level, as we've established that sexual intercourse and procreation are markers of excellence amongst the guardians, the number of individuals who could be counted amongst a particular individual guardian's offspring would be visible markers of that guardian's personal excellence. And indeed, these would be markers that would endure long after the fleeting recognition associated with being selected for a particular procreation event. As long as those children live, you can point to them and say, look how great I am, look at all my children. And if female guardians were automatically included, as the text suggests, in all marriage lotteries, as well as the extra instances of procreation, which are awarded to only the best male guardians, it is entirely possible and indeed likely that even the least accomplished female guardian would produce more offspring than even the most accomplished male. So there would be demonstrably more visible markers of an individual female guardian's excellence in the form of offspring than there would be for an individual male guardian. And the second level is, again, because Plato gives special importance and ideological value to terms associated with kinship to create this cohesion between the guardians and indeed foster fond feeling amongst his guardian class as a whole, it stands to reason that this sort of societally promoted significance given to terms such as mother and father would be intensified in the minds of the offspring when they were being applied to those individuals who actually took part in the procreation event that produced them. So if offspring were inclined to feel any special feeling or show any particular reverence towards those that they were encouraged to look upon as their collective mothers and fathers, female guardians would receive such veneration from more individuals than would male guardians. Now, whether or not the ideological fallout of guardian breeding was at all deliberate on Plato's part is another matter entirely. And here is where we get to the really interesting bit, because I am absolutely not claiming that Plato intentionally gave female guardians this ideological advantage, nor am I even suggesting that Plato was necessarily aware of the implications that his measures would have had for comparative gendered excellence between the guardians. Rather, it's likely that the scenario I described is a mere side effect of measures that were put in place by Plato due to logistical concerns. Because when introducing the idea of female guardians, Plato Socrates asserts that at every level of society, there will be individual females who exhibit aptitudes equivalent and even superior to those of their male counterparts. And Plato even accepts the likelihood that women would possess the particular excellences and abilities needed to be counted amongst the philosopher rulers, the highest position within the society of Republic. And of course, if you want the best possible society, as Plato does, it would be foolish to exclude anyone who has a capacity for excellence from the roles which require it. So this provides Plato his justification for the system of the Republic, which grants full equality of opportunity for males and females, but which does not expect equality of outcome. You see, well, Plato Socrates is happy to accept the idea that individual women will often outstrip their male counterparts. He also suggests that in terms of aggregate performance and abilities, the genus or race of males taken as a whole are seen to outperform that of females taken as a whole. So Plato's evaluation of the proportionality of males versus females who would embody the necessary virtues for guardianship suggests that he thought there would be notably fewer female than male guardians. Thus, his discussion of male competition for opportunities to procreate with females could simply be the result of his assumption that the numerical disparity between male and female guardians would necessitate the participation of all female guardians in all of these procreation events in order to maintain the ideal level of procreation. Now, you might be asking right about now, so what's the point? Why are you going on and on and on and on about something that is a mere footnote and probably something that Plato never even thought about when he set out his system? Now, you might ask, even, is it not, you know, are you not being pedantic? Are you not, you know, hammering a point that doesn't need to be hammered? Well, yes, I'm being pedantic, but also no. You see, this to me is the most interesting part of the whole arrangement, because it is this very fact of Plato's underestimation of women that provides this entire foundation for the measures which would ultimately serve to give female guardians an edge over their male counterparts. And here is where I'm going to bring in a bit of that social constructionist gender theory that I use in my research. So constructionist theories argue that even though societies might set out institutions or make arrangements or lay out particular ideals with particular purposes in mind, once these things are established within living, breathing society, these institutions and ideals and arrangements tend to take on lives of their own. And over time, they can come to take on radically different meanings than those for which they were created, particularly after a few generations when there's distance between the social structures and their origins. And interestingly, we actually get a similar idea about how ideology can take withhold or can take hold within a society from the Republic itself, not as it relates to male and female procreation, but as it relates with how the rulers will prevent the wrong sort of people from taking power. You see, Socrates decides that to prevent lesser individuals from holding power, citizens will all be told this myth, this noble lie that people are essentially all born composed of different metals, bronze and silver and gold. And what metal you are matches your capacity and your proper role within society. And so, of course, you should never let someone with a bronze nature rule. It's got to be the men with the gold nature or the women with the gold nature. And when his dialogue partners ask him if he thought that people would actually believe this myth, he says basically, well, probably not the first generation, but hopefully after a few generations they will. So my point is that regardless of Plato's motivations in creating these breeding regulations in the first place, the symbolic and ideological fallout remains the same. And of course, Republic is a city of thought. Indeed, Plato never thought it would be practicable in the real world. But if the scenario Plato constructed were to play out within the context of a real society, it is very likely that over time, the honor associated with procreation in combination with this very significant gendered imbalance in application would serve to significantly advantage women in terms of the societal ideology of competitive excellence. And if, as is likely, Plato's assessment of the expected ratio of female to male guardians turned out to be wrong, and there were actually far more women who would possess those qualities suitable for guardianship than he had anticipated, the effect of these measures on the perception of female excellence would be even more significant. So while some have viewed the arrangements for guardian procreation as disempowering to the women involved or indicative of a male orientation of the city in Republic, this same description viewed from a different perspective and taking on different ideological concerns can actually suggest that female guardian would have a symbolic advantage over the male guardian by virtue of her uncontested right to procreate. Okay, so that is all I have to say about that. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Here is a bit of bibliography, and if anyone has any questions, I would welcome discussion.
All right, thank you. That was fantastic. We do have a couple questions here. One from Brittany. Brittany say, thank you for an amazing talk. I was wondering if you could talk a bit about your thoughts on Plato's hint of a third gender in his work, The Symposium, and if we would see any other hint of this idea in The Republic or any other work of his?
Right. Symposium is a tricky one. I believe you're referring to the speech, actually a very beautiful, poetic, and oft-quoted speech that talks about essentially this idea of the other half, where, you know, there's this myth that originally mankind was two, split down the middle with faces pointing in different directions. The gods grew angry with mankind because of their presumption and essentially punished them by splitting them down the middle. And there is this idea of a third gender, in the sense that the original mankind was separated into three, the one that was double male, the one that was double female, and the one that was male-female. And this is given as a justification for the various sexual preferences. I say preferences rather than orientation, because in the ancient Greek world, they did not have understanding of sexual orientation as we do today. So I just wanted to draw that distinction in how we treat it. It's interesting in a couple of ways, especially because it's kind of interesting in how it treats the various orientations or preferences, because we get this idea that the males who love males, and they're specific again because it's the pederasts, the males who are attracted to boys rather than other adult men, are the ones who are philosophically minded and political and whatnot. And the females that are attracted to females, well, that's natural. But actually a lot of flack is given to the males who are attracted to females. They're the adulterers and the lecherers and the cowards. So it has a kind of interesting take on the whole thing that I don't think is necessarily flattering to anyone. And it's a bit of a tricky thing anyway, because within the symposium, we have a number of speeches that are given by different guests. And this speech was meant to be given by the comedic poet Aristophanes, and the dramatist. He wrote plays, actually, several of them at Socrates' expense. So it's not at all clear that Plato thinks that this is a good or accurate description of the world at large. In fact, Plato gives a different idea of the nature of love, which is actually positive towards women. He speaks of, you know, this great philosopher woman, and there's all this beautiful metaphor about, you know, philosophy and female creation and things like that. So I don't know if that answered your question at all, but yeah, that idea of the third gender in Aristophanes' speech, while beautiful, is a whole can of worms that would take way too long to try to unpack.
Also here, Brittany would like to ask a second question. I'm curious about this imbalance of the lottery between men and women guardians, where all women were equal valued, where there was men had to earn their status. Is this because women have proved their excellence naturally, since their roles is birth givers, and because of the risk of giving birth, women had an important value to the society?
Yes and no. That's certainly my argument here. So my argument being that it probably was just a practical concern that could come to take on very significant ideological considerations that could, over successive generations, actually turn. That was a very good description of what it could turn into, and why successive generations would assume that women were ultimately and uncontestedly able to participate in excellence in this way. It could definitely take on that meaning. But in terms of Plato's thoughts on the matter, I don't think so, because actually it's a bit awkward. Earlier in Republic, when he's talking about the justification for males and females to both participate in the guardian way of life, he actually compares people to dogs. And he says, well, we wouldn't make any difference between male dogs and female dogs. The only difference is that the male begets and the woman bears. And so it should be with the guardians. And in fact, the role of mother was not meant to be a large part of a guardian woman's life, as in the sense of the nurturing aspect. Certainly she could point to her offspring and gain honor of it in the same way that a male guardian could, but actually there were a number of regulations in the Republic that were meant to minimize a woman's role as mother. If she was a guardian, all the children were to be taken away and raised by nurses, and the women would go and breastfeed, but that would be the extent of it, and they would just be given a random child. They wouldn't know if it was theirs or not, and the idea is to make the act of childbearing as unlaborious as possible so that women could get on with the more elevated roles as guardians and protectors of the Republic.
Thank you, Dr. Hayden. Let's see here. We also got another question. You mentioned that Plato's attitude towards women are not consistent throughout his work. Can you tell us a bit more about what about that, and also explain why Pluto's treatment of women in the Republic should be preferred over his other works?
Right. That is a tricky one, and you'll get different interpretations based on the scholar. I would argue, we've seen a bit how Plato's treatment differs from the downright insulting to this idea of a genderless excellence in the Republic. And it's interesting because the works where Plato is actually less flattering towards women, like the Timaeus and the Laws, are actually later than the Republic. So some could make the argument that, oh, well, maybe Plato had this ideal at one time, but as he went on in life, he had a lesser estimation of women. Whereas I would argue against that because the Timaeus is a completely different thing. It's very metaphysical. It's very about, you know, the divine and the unmoved mover and things like that. So it's an entirely different kettle of fish. But I think with Republic is really, we see Plato's gold standards. In a perfect world, if we didn't have the influences of society and, you know, the problems with the societies that currently exist, if we could plan this thing from the ground up and indoctrinate the people into right thinking, then we would have truly genderless excellence. And in Republic itself, he says that he doesn't think this is possible because of the way of the world. And Laws, which is meant to be his sort of realistic attempt, does try to integrate women in society. And it's interesting because the resistance that he anticipates facing from women is not represented as a result of them being inferior in their internal nature. He blames current societies, which are oppressive to women. He says it's because society as it stands secludes women and relegates them to the private sphere and habituates them in this way that we will have difficulty, not because the women themselves are in any way inherently inferior. So I think that Republic is, you know, if we're going to look at what Plato wanted in his heart of hearts, it's Republic.
That's very insightful. Thank you. Let's see here. Another question. You mentioned the political ideological underpinning associated with the methodology of academic feminism. Does your approach have any ideological hangups? And if so, why do you prefer it is to a feminist framework?
Right. So this is the thing, right? Inevitably, we are all people. We all have our viewpoints that are informed by society and culture, and we have our biases. And it is a very difficult task when we're looking at a society that is not our own to be as objective as possible. And academic feminism, and here I will distinguish academic feminism with feminism as a popular and political and much needed movement, because even though they are different things, they are so entwined to the point where you can't really divorce the one from the other. So to, you know, try to take the concern for female liberation out of feminism would make it not feminism. Whereas my approach, because I feel the need to be as objective as I can when looking at societies and values that are not my own. I like the social constructionist approach, not because it doesn't have hangups. It definitely does. Actually, it has a lot of the similar hangups to feminism. It's very politically rooted. It actually was born out of the feminist movement, social constructionist gender theories. And so it takes on a lot of the same political and ideological values, but because it is more abstracted, because it is less tangible in the world we live in, it's easier to take those aspects out of it and use it as a more elastic framework to look at things objectively. For instance, one of the theories I use, hegemonic theory of masculinity, argues that, you know, regardless of what else goes on, women are the primary subjugated class in all systems of gender. But when we're looking at the ancient Greek world, a lot of the time we're looking at texts that don't talk about women at all. It was a men's world, but you can remove that aspect of, okay, look for the women's role. You can take that out of the framework and apply it to men, and you can still see the kind of stratification that you would see if women were present.
Wonderful, thank you. We got a question from Joshua. Excellent talk, thank you very much. Two quick questions. Can you say a bit about the significance, if any, of the role of mothers in the decline of regimes in book 8?
Sorry, what was that? I didn't get the last bit. In the decline of?
Regimes in book 8.
Oh, are you talking about where Plato talks about the, you know, he has the system of where essentially the aristocracy, the rule by the best, that denigrates into an oligarchy, rule of the few, which denigrates into democracy, rule of the honor-loving, denigrates to oligarchy, rule of the few, denigrates into eventually democracy, which he views as the worst of the worst, incidentally. I think that's what you're referring to. Actually, it's not really a big thing, although there is one really interesting passage in the description of how a democracy, the honor-loving society, turns into a oligarchy, which is the rule of the few, which is characterized by materialism and avarice and cruelty. And actually the role of the mother is very important in that progression, but it's not in the way that you might think, because he talks about the society as a whole, but then he talks about a hypothetical individual. And he talks about, you know, this young democratic boy who's growing up, and his father is a good man. He's, you know, maybe a little simple, maybe doesn't, you know as much about philosophy as he should, but he is honor driven and he's not concerned with material gain and wealth. But the mother doesn't like this, because she sees other people in society who have more than her and whose husbands have more status than her. And so she complains to her husband, but he doesn't listen because he doesn't care. So instead she turns to her son and she says, look at your father. He's not a real man. This is what real men do. They go out and they get property and they get status for our household. And so then the boy is caught between these competing system of values, and eventually materialism takes hold, which I think says a lot about Plato's view of, you know, the private sphere in general, but also women's role within the private sphere and their influence in shaping their sons and the people who will go out and become politically dominant, which is, I think, a large part of the reason that he was so anxious that women should be taken out of the house and put in society with everyone else.
Right. Thank you. There's part two of this question. What should we make of Socrates' complex formula that produces marriage number?
Oh, dear. You're really putting my feet to the flames with that. Forests have been felled over that. In the work I wrote on this, there is a footnote about that long about there's in the Republic, there is this very convoluted equation, and you know, it's about the moon and the numbers, and there are all these math that don't make sense at all. And somehow at the end of this, you arrive at the appropriate intervals and the best times where procreation should be enacted. And the short and unsatisfying answer is that no one really knows. People are still arguing, and no one knows exactly what Plato was trying to get at there.
All right. Let's see here. We also got a question from Amber. I have read an article recently about how new translations of Homer's epics from the original texts are providing different interpretation of the writing, that they are finding that many of the patriarchal misogynistic phrasing were actually choice of the original translators rather than of the writings itself, and that often the original language was not gendered at all, and that was a choice added by the bias of the translation. Is this something that has ever been looked at in the works of Plato and others?
I'm not sure about that specific, how much has been done with the translations of Plato specifically. Most people who will be looking into the little bits of Plato will be trying to look at the original Greek. However, you are absolutely right, especially in terms of the overarching understanding of what any original author is trying to portray. And that's a very important point. And actually, we are somewhat at a disadvantage because as English speakers, the great translators were largely from the Victorian era. And it's actually funny because it still is reflected in the dictionaries. If you go to, because of course, you know, Victorian sensibilities, anything related to sex or rather awkward language, you'll go to the big Greek dictionary to try to look up the word. It won't give you an English word. It'll give you the Latin word. And then you'll go to the Latin dictionary and it'll give you the Greek word. And you can do that till the end of time. And this is beside the point, but I think it's, you make a very good point that the sensibilities and the values of the translator is absolutely going to impact the way they translate. And so we need to be very careful, which is why it's so important to try to get as close to the original sources as we can before we decide what they're in fact saying about these things. And certainly Homeric society was much more pro-woman than even classical Greece in a lot of ways. If you look at things like Odyssey, Penelope has a virtue on par with Odysseus, you know, and they're really represented as partners. And so there's all these lovely things that we would like, these sort of ideas that we put on the ancient world. And it's really interesting, especially in terms of gender. Sorry, I'm rambling on, but I just want to say, because there, it's really interesting because the Western tradition loves to see its heritage in the ancient Greeks and Latin. And yet so many of the hangups that we have about gender and emotionality and sexuality and things like that, aren't really in those sources. You know, I was translating a work the other day where a general as a emotionally manipulative tool, when his army wasn't behaving the way he wanted to, stood up before them and cried for like 20 minutes before giving a speech to give them a guilt trip. And these are things that, you know, if we thought, what, a Spartan did that, because of our own cultural perceptions, we would not expect it. And yet we're putting so much onto the Greek that does not need to be there. So it's kind of interesting.
Wow. Very insightful. Let's see here. Any other question, patrons? Please feel free to use the chat to ask questions. In the meantime, Dr. Hayden, would you like to talk a little bit more about the talk in terms of the overall or some last comments?
Just I hope you all enjoyed it. I hope I wasn't being too pedantic. I know that it can be a bit of a pain to look at something so tiny, but it's funny because sometimes in my mind, it's the tiniest things that can make huge differences. And so I hope that you enjoyed that.
Thank you. I don't see any more questions. All right. So I suppose we could wrap up the program if I don't see any, you know, question pop up in the next 10 seconds. Okay. I believe you can also press down the space bar to speak if you feel more comfortable in terms of, you know, just talking out loud rather than typing in the chat. You can just simply, patrons, press down the space bar and you can directly speak. All right. I think that's it for tonight. Thank you all for spending your beautiful Wednesday evening with us and Dr. Hayden for your terrific and insightful presentation. I personally enjoyed it a lot and learned quite a bit. So patrons, as you know, this is our last Ancient World series. Please join our next new lecture series, Exploring Religion, on Wednesday, March 10th from 7 to 8:30 p.m. Do check out our website for more information and registration at calgarylibrary.ca. Have a great evening.
Thanks very much.
Thank you all.